All right. Hello, everyone. In this interview, I get to talk to Whit Stillman, director of such films as Metropolitan, Barcelona, Last Days of Disco, and the upcoming film Damsels in Distress. This film is opening up in Indianapolis this weekend, and he sat down with me to chat about the film. And I got to see this earlier this year, and I got to say it is by far my favorite film of the year so far. I really, really enjoyed this. It's a really fun film. Great film. Check it out and enjoy the interview. All right. Hello, everyone. This is Andy Hunsucker, one of the hosts of the IU Cinema podcast, and I'm on the phone with director and writer Whit Stillman. His new film, Damsels in Distress, just opened in Indianapolis, and thanks so much for coming on the show, Whit.
Thanks a lot for having me.
So I saw this film back in April, late March, when it was at the cinema, and when you were here visiting the cinema. And I got to say, it's got to be my favorite movie of the year so far. I really, really enjoyed it. But maybe you could just describe the premise to people so they have a sense of what they're going to get, what they're going to see at the movie.
Okay. Well, we've done. In the 90s, I did three films: Metropolitan, Barcelona, and Last Days of Disco. And this film, Damsels in Distress, shares some qualities of them. But it's more of a sort of stylized comedy. It's more a fantasy land version of university life. There's still sort of a lot of issues dealt with it. It's about a group of girls who decide to try to improve things on their campus, and they run into a lot of flack for doing that.
Yeah, and it's interesting, the fantasy aspect of it, sort of the fantastical aspect. That's what really sort of struck me about the movie, that it's sort of realistic, but on the same hand, it's got that sort of air of hyper-reality that all of your films do. So I'm wondering, all of your other films kind of have a personal aspect to them, so they sort of touch on something that either really happened to you or a world you were a part of. What about this film, if any anything, is personal for you?
Well, you know, when you're writing a script, you sort of can't avoid that all kinds of stuff comes into it, and it's sort of hard to analyze exactly where it's coming in. But the lead character, played by Greta Gerwig, she has all sorts of experiences in her backstory, and some of them, you know, I remember. I did go into a kind of funk right before I arrived at freshman year in college, and I can't blame it on the college at all. It was something that sort of happened to me. And so I know that experience of being, you know, on a college campus and feeling totally weird and out of it. And she goes through that for more logical reasons. There's a contretemps, a setback in her life that she reacts to. And so although it's a comedy, there's some serious stuff in it and some sort of sincere stuff. And we don't want to show that too much because it's mostly about the humor. But there's that too.
Yeah. So you are sort of known for having your stable of actors. You've worked, in almost all of your films, you've got this sort of the same group of actors. But this one has pretty much an entirely fresh set of actors. What was it like sort of going through that process when you didn't have your, you know, your normal actors to fall back on?
It's funny. I was just with a filmmaker last night, and he was saying that he likes to explain to actors who come in for auditions that actually it's the people behind the table who seem like they have all the power, the people doing the casting, who are actually the most terrified. Because the people doing the casting are terrified they will not find the people who can do their project. They will not find, you know, that right person that will make it work. And so I faced that this time, and it's kind of a happy process in certain ways because, in my case, finally I had a film and good backing for the film and good casting people working on it. But with the 12-year gap in films, I could no longer use the people I'd worked with before. There are two actors from Metropolitan who play adult parts in this film.
Yeah.
But for the kids, I needed new people, and I didn't know any of these people. I was introduced to them by the casting people.
Yeah. So you've got your two lead actors here, Greta Gerwig and Adam Brody, who sort of have, depending on what, you know, groups you're into, what sort of entertainment you pay attention to, you will either know them and love them or you'll sort of not know who they are. But I think they're both really brilliant. And what's brilliant about them is how they sort of play off of each other. So
yeah.
did you audition them together to sort of see how that was going to work?
I never did. I was really lucky that way. And it was sort of the beginning and the end of the casting process. Greta, I'd say, was in a sense cast first, and that really helped us because in Hollywood, in the business, it's always the next thing, and Greta was the next thing, so yeah. She was, you know, very hot and justifiably so. She's really great. But I was really stuck for getting the leading man. I mean, getting the fellow who would be the sort of the romantic glue holding a lot of the threads together. And fortuitously, I had a trip to Los Angeles that I hadn't expected. It was actually kind of a tough experience. I was supposed to go out to pitch a TV project to the networks, and I was being, you know, brought out by one of the companies, and they suddenly canceled my trip, decided my project wasn't ready to pitch yet, and they canceled all my tickets. I said, but I'm coming out. So I had to rebuy tickets, and I'm really glad I went out, because I continued the casting and found Adam Brody. And I hadn't watched, I mean, I think I'd watched OC once, but I hadn't really focused on who was who. And he was just terrific. He read for the part, and was just great. And finally, I had the missing piece of the puzzle.
Yeah. So a lot of directors have a visual style. You have almost like an auditory style. Your characters all sort of have this voice that they speak in, this very kind of, I always describe to people, every character in a Whit Stillman movie is absolutely earnest about everything they're saying. How hard is it to get in the audition process for actors? Do some of them just not get what, or do they just sort of try to do that for you? And how does that work?
You worry me a little bit, because, I mean, I hope the characters sound different.
Well, yes, of course, but they all have sort of, yeah.
I mean, I did notice in the auditioning process, we had one session in New York, I think it was the first session in New York, and it was terrifying because, like, the script just sounded terrible in everyone's mouths. I mean, it just, I was saying, oh my gosh, this is a mess and this is terrible. And then a young actress was there who just read it beautifully and made it really funny and really interesting. And I didn't know who she was, but she had just made an acclaimed film called Tiny Furniture, and it was Lena Dunham.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and now
that makes a lot of sense.
And she sort of saved the audition session for us, because I think we were all sort of panicking, like maybe the script was totally misconceived, but she found the humor in it and brought that out. And she ended up helping us quite a bit, because she introduced me to her co-producer on Tiny Furniture, who figured out a way to do our film really economically and yet really have it a comfortable shoot. And that helped a lot. And Lena was supposed to play a cameo in the movie, and unfortunately, by the time we were shooting, she was already rehearsing for her pilot, Girls.
Okay.
And so she couldn't do it. But I actually think she could have done it, but I sort of let it get out of my hands, and a lot of people really loved the actress they cast instead. They didn't really know who Lena was, so I think, you know, you try to control sort of every detail in your production, and this wasn't exactly a detail, it was kind of a big thing. But it would have been wonderful having her in the film, but Aaliyah Shawkat's really good too.
Yeah, and it's interesting you say that, because I just saw Tiny Furniture, and I was thinking, she clearly could count you as an influence, you know, just with the style of that film.
Well, I think that, you know, a lot of us are sort of, I used to not really cite the Woody Allen influence, because it just seemed like it's too big a thing. It's like, yeah, you know, long established and big. But it's almost as if he created the oxygen on the planet that we all breathe.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't have to be like a direct thing. And I think a lot of those, you know, questions of who's influencing whom and all that, it's just liking a lot of the same things. And then you end up kind of in similar spaces, but it's because you like the same things. It's not like you're copying each other.
Yeah. So let's talk about, like most of your films, in fact, all of your films, there's a heavy dance element in this film in particular. So where does that come from in your life, and does that just always come out of you in your script, or do you sit down and think, how do I get a dance sequence into this film?
Well, before we scare people, I should say, it's not that heavy. I mean, it's sort of about, I mean, the idea of it is big in the film, but it's kind of a sinewy thing where there's suggestions of dance, because I find it, you know, if it's not Fred Astaire or Busby Berkeley, that a lot of dance sequences are dead space in films. And so one reason why the real dancing numbers tend to be right at the end is because I didn't want to sort of stop the plot to have a dance number. And, but psychologically and sort of idealistically, dance, the idea of dance is very important. And I suppose more and more I noticed that it would come up in the other films, and Last Days of Disco is a lot about that. But, you know, I just think it's a really desirable thing in social life. And so if there was a character trying to foment a nicer, more fun, more civilized social life, it could involve dancing in these forms. And so I think that's why it became intellectually big in this film.
Yeah. Well, I say, you know...
But I don't want to scare people.
Oh, yes.
It's not
a musical per se, but there is one character who's sort of obsessed with dance and the idea of creating a dance craze. So let's talk about the Sambola, and let's talk about how we can get this to become a real dance craze, because I think it's worthy.
Thanks, I agree. Well, next week, actually, we're trying to put on the internet the Sambola dance scene from the film.
Oh, excellent.
We thought that we can film it and try to do dance lessons and that kind of stuff, and there has been an attempt at that. But the dance sequence in the film is pretty funny and pretty attractive. And so I think we'll just let that go as a music video, the Sambola International Dance Craze music video.
Oh, that's going to be great. I'm really looking forward to seeing that again. I think we'll stop there.
That's great.
So Whit Stillman, thank you so much for sitting down with us. I really appreciate it. And go see Damsels in Distress.
Thanks a lot.
A Place for Film is recorded at WFIU Studios in Bloomington, Indiana.